Hello everyone, good morning, good afternoon, good evening, depending upon when you are watching this video lecture. Today let's discuss about an extension of process costing, one more small topic called joint products and byproducts. Basically, the major requirement, or we can say the learning outcome of this chapter, is to understand various methods of apportionment of joint costs. So, what is joint product, byproduct? What is the difference between them? These are, yes, theoretically understandable, but majorly, how to apportion the joint costs is the numerical aspect related to this chapter. But before going to that, let us understand what is a joint product and what is a byproduct. In general, when we use the word joint product, we are talking about the processing of some manufacturing activity that is happening, and the outcome of that manufacturing process gives rise to multiple products after some time. The best way of understanding joint products is an example of crude oil, very particularly. That is the best way, best example for joint products also. For example, if crude oil is there, that will be refined first, and after that lot of activity will happen. We don't need to really know all that activity. We are not petroleum engineers, we are not engineers first of all, and we are not supposed to be engineers also. So something they will do for making the crude oil usable to the final consumers, but while doing so, there will be certain activities up to certain point of split off, and there will be some more activities after the point of split off, and joint products will emerge out of that entire process. For example, petrol and diesel coming out of the same crude oil. So the input is same, but outputs are many. That means there are two or more products of sometimes equal or sometimes unequal importance are produced simultaneously while manufacturing one of the products, that is a main product. Sometimes there will be a main product and some byproducts possible. For example, sugar manufacturing industry will have sugar as a main product, molasses as a byproduct. That cannot be called as a joint product. When they are of unequal importance, we can call them byproducts. When both the products are of almost equal importance, exactly equal may not be, but almost equal importance, like petrol, diesel, can be called as joint products. Both of them coming from same raw material, that is crude oil. So in such industries, the major challenge will be how the common costs have to be apportioned among various products. There will be some common costs before the actual split of petrol and diesel happens. A lot of costs will be there before that. Those can be called common costs or joint costs. And those costs have to be apportioned to the joint products on some suitable basis. Other than that also, there will be some other aspects which we don't look at, that is practical issues. But as far as our objective in this chapter is concerned, we can rest assured consider it as only one objective: to identify a proper, appropriate basis for apportionment of common costs or joint costs, or the costs incurred before split off. How to allocate them, how to apportion them to different products is our major challenge. In this, we will have naturally two types of situations. One is joint products, where two or more products are separated in the course of the same processing operation, and each product separately cannot be called as a major product. You cannot call diesel as a major product when compared with petrol, or vice versa. So both of them are almost having equal importance, almost. So we can call them joint products in that case. As usual, the oil industry is the best example. So many products will come out of that. Of course, we cannot call all of them as joint products. Yes, some which are having reasonable value, those will have same name called joint products. So gasoline and all tells that this is all copied pasted from some American material. We call it petrol, diesel. Some of the lubricants will come out of that. Paraffin, tar, something will come out of that. We don't know all of them. Kerosene, of course, we know. But all of them are coming from the crude petroleum. We can call them as joint products. Let us not go into all that. For us, let us simply understand, because we know them, petrol, diesel are joint products coming from same crude petroleum as an input. Then what are byproducts? These are the products which are also coming out of the same processing operation, but they are not main products. They are either secondary products or subsidiary products, which will also come as a result of the manufacture of main product. Then we can call them as byproducts. So these are the products which are recovered from the material which is discarded in the main process. When sugar manufacturing happens, all the sugar cane, after getting squeezed out of its juice, that is all useless scrap. From that, molasses is also possible to emerge as one of its byproducts. So once again, we don't have to be really technically good enough in understanding how the manufacturing happens, but at least we can imagine things with our little creativity. Yes, in case of joint products, the products, multiple products are having more or less similar importance. In case of byproducts, the byproduct is not having a similar importance as main product. So there is something called main product here. Sugar is the main product, molasses is the byproduct. That's what is given as example here also. Same way, while manufacturing soaps, it looks like, we don't know, I never seen any soap manufacturing, maybe something. Glycerin is also obtained as a byproduct, it seems. Same way, when carbonization of coal happens, tar, ammonia and benzol, something happens. We are not chemical engineers, we don't need to know all this. But all that we need to know is, when a main product is manufactured, there is a possibility of a byproduct also emerging out of same process of manufacturing, which will be of relatively lesser importance compared with the main product. That's what is byproduct. In case of joint product, we cannot distinguish the importance of them. More or less, the joint products will have almost relatively equal importance. There is nothing called main product in case of joint products. In case of byproducts, there is a main product and byproduct, like that. That's it. That is the basic understanding of what is joint product and byproduct. Basically, theoretical understanding. Theory question can be definitely asked. What is the difference between joint product and byproduct? Explain with examples. Like this, questions can be asked. As we already discussed, joint products are generally of equal importance, whereas byproducts are produced incidentally or in addition to the main products. So in case of byproducts, there is something called a main product also. And byproducts generally are having small economic value. Joint products will have equal importance among themselves. That's it. So two differences if we can take. Joint products are of equal importance and they are produced simultaneously, whereas byproducts are having lesser economic value and they are incidentally produced in addition to the main products. There is one more word called co-products. Sometimes, we don't know, a short note can be asked like these points also, because nobody gives a importance to that. Paper setter may give such short note. What is a co-product? Joint products, co-products, both are more or less same, but point is, co-products do not emerge necessarily from the same material in the same process. So they can be called as co-products. For example, this is the best example we can say. The timber boards made from different trees. Different trees are there. All of them were cut and brought to the timber depot. Boards are all made, but input is not same. There is a teak wood also, there is a mango wood also, rosewood also, or whatever other, neem also. Different types of trees are there. All of them are finally made into timber boards. co-products, those are all timber boards, but not coming from same input. Same way, when there is a farming that is happening related to wheat and gram in different farms, they can be called as co-products. So that is basic difference between a joint product and co-product. Joint product will have the same input, co-product might have different inputs. That's it. These are the 3 points related to theoretical aspect. Now coming to the core aspect where we have to apply is how to apportion the joint costs. That is a very important aspect, because one of the important decisions also which is to be taken is whether the product should be further processed or should they be sold at split off stage only. So to understand the joint products concept, just imagine there is some process that is going on, and in that process, up to certain level, there are certain activities which are all done up to certain level. What are all those? We don't know. We don't need also. That is all technical things. But so many activities are done, lot of cost is incurred up to this level. This level is what we can call it as split off point. So let us call this as a split off point. Till split off point, lot of joint costs are incurred. After split off point, different processes happened and different products have come out. Let us say different 4 products came out after the split off point. But this process is different. This process is different. So each of the products has a different process, different cost. Post split off, they have a different cost. And there is no issue with them, because they are anyway clear how much is incurred for product A, how much cost is incurred post split off for this product. We know that this is the cost incurred for that. But in this joint cost, how much should be given to A? That is our question mark. That is the answer we are trying to find. So the main challenge here is how the joint costs have to be apportioned to different joint products when there is a split off point. That is first point. And why that is useful? Sometimes it may be better for the organization to sell certain products here itself rather than processing further, because that may not be profitable. So whether to process further or not also is a decision on the basis of this apportionment of joint costs that we do, which helps in managerial decision making also. So this is the core aspect here, and what we have to understand here is split off point is an important word, technical word. Up to split off point, we can call this also as a point of separation. Up to this point, whatever costs are incurred, those are all the costs called as joint costs. And what we have to do with them? They have to be apportioned among different joint products on some suitable basis. What is a suitable basis? That is what we are going to know. There are many bases which are possible where we can apportion these joint costs to. The joint products are byproducts. So what about the costs incurred after the split off point? After the split off point, there is no problem with them. Why? Because they are directly available, identifiable with individual joint product. So that is very evident. That is not a problem. Problem comes only with joint costs, not with the post split off costs, after separation costs. Those are very much identifiable with each of the products clearly. There is no issue there. Issue comes with joint costs. Now, how to apportion this joint cost? There are different types of methods here. We can use physical units method or NRV method, the most popular and method, practical method, which we will use. Even if in the question nothing is mentioned, this is the method we have to use, net realizable value method. Using technical estimates, we cannot do. That has to be done practically. So this is something that we cannot do. But physical units is something we can just do some arithmetic exercise. Net realizable value at split off point is also a very important method. That is the only one, actually the most practical method of separating the joint costs among joint products or byproducts. And there are some other methods also which can be taken. For example, taking the market value at the point of separation, if it is available, we can take that. Market value after further processing, if it is available, we can do that. Average unit cost method, or even contribution margin method. Like these different methods can be used for the segregation of joint costs apportioned to different joint products. All of them we will definitely understand, but mostly in the problems or the numerical questions that we face in the exam, the core area is this method, that is net realizable value method. NRV method is the core method which we are supposed to apply in the problems also. But yes, we will understand how each of the methods can be applied for apportioning the joint cost. The first one is physical unit method. Name itself indicates. Physical unit means it could be weight, numbers, liters, meters, whatever it is. On that basis only the joint costs can be apportioned. So the point here, once again, most important thing in this chapter, what we are looking at is only one thing, that is basis of apportionment. Remaining all data is there already. What is the basis of apportionment is the question. Basis of apportionment, if it is physical units, so be it. We can do that segregation very easily. So let us take this illustration number one. Coke manufacturing company. Coke is not Coca-Cola. That is like one of the kinds of coal. It is carbon related something. Anyway, we don't need that. Coke manufacturing company is not Coca-Cola. That much we should know. Coke is a popular word used for Coca-Cola and other bad stuff also. But this is not the one we are talking about. We are talking about this carbon related industry. Coal related industry. So they use... they produce the following products by using 5000 tons of coal. So that is the input. 5000 tons, right, of coal is inputted at the rate of 1100 rupees per ton. That is the input cost. So that's okay. But that has been inputted into a common process and output is like this. There are so many joint products here. Coke has come out of that, tar has come out of that, sulfate or whatever, benzol, something, something. We don't need to really go about that. For us, they are ABCD, enough. ABCD is enough. Some names are given in the exam, we will write those names, but in the mind, we should not think about them. What is the sulfate of ammonia and all? We are not chemical engineers. We don't need to know that. How benzol is useful in life doesn't matter to us. It matters for general knowledge. That's a different story. So as far as these questions are concerned, we just have to consider as good as ABCD, that's all. And what our job here is to prepare a statement apportioning the joint costs among the products on the basis of physical unit method. So this method is also popularly asked also in the exams. So we should just know how this method can be used for apportioning the joint costs. First and foremost thing, how much is the joint cost? Let us first have a look at that. This is a simple arithmetic exercise. How much is the joint cost? 5000 tons of coal is there. At the rate of 1100 per ton. So this is the overall joint cost that is there. The cost of materials, let us say. That is the cost of coal. Right? This has to be allocated to different products. Coke, tar, etc., etc. So let us take them as C, T, S, B. Don't write this in the exam. You have to write full forms there. And look at the number of tons that have been out produced actually. It has been only 3500 tons of coke, 1252 48. So 1252 48. Now these are the number of tons that are produced out of input of 5000 tons of coal. But if you observe the total of this, total of all this, if we say, that is coming to only 4800. It is not 5000. So what happened to that 200 tons? It would have been lost. Naturally, some loss will happen during the process. So irrespective of all this, we can just apportion this cost 55 lakhs in this ratio. That is 35 is to 12 is to 5.2 is to 4.8. So let us just take the joint costs directly. Just a simple calculation. 55 lakhs divided by 4800 multiplied with 3500. So how much is the joint cost that has been apportioned to this coke is 40,10,417. Like that, we can have same things for others also. Of course, make sure the total of all of that is matching to 55 lakhs. Yes, that is the apportionment on the basis of physical units. 40, 10, 4, 1, 7. But some rounding error may be there. So here, 40 lakhs 10,000 something, 13 lakhs 75,000 like that, 59,400 something like that. So the total 55 lakhs has to be apportioned in this ratio. There was unnecessary step that was done here, which is 200 units again apportioned in the same ratio. After that, we are using that for apportioning. When you are using the same ratio, how does it matter whether there is wastage or not? If there is a wastage separately given, then it's a different story. When the ratio is same, if you apportion wastage also in the same ratio, net weight also will be in the same ratio, right? It doesn't make any difference. So ratio is what matters to us. Ratio is this. This is the weight ratio. In this ratio, we have to apportion the total cost, and total is 55 lakhs. That's it. That is weight. Nothing to basically do any great job there. It is a simple arithmetical apportionment of joint costs on the basis of weight. That's it. But the most important one is net realizable value method at split off. What is net realizable value at split off? So basically, we are using the possible realizable value at split off if these joint products are sold before further processing, but they are not sold before further processing. If they are sold at further processing, how much would have been the net realizable value that we are checking? But we are not talking about the market value of the products at that stage. We are talking about products getting completed. They will be sold after further processing. But going by a backward calculation, we are all going to reduce the estimated profit margin and any selling and distribution expenses and further processing costs, which can also be called as post-split off costs. So that what we get as a resultant figure is net realizable value at the time of split off. So this is a simple format for a calculation of net realizable value. How to calculate net realizable value? Final sales value. This is not sales value at split off. Be careful. Sales value means after completion of entire further processing, finally how much sales value would that be? Naturally, number of units into selling price. Deduct profit margin from that. It should be given in the question. We have to do that. Deduct selling and distribution expenses from that. Should be given in the question. We should deduct that. And post split off cost. Post split off cost can also be called as further processing costs. So further processing costs, if you deduct from this overall sales that can be achieved after further processing, in addition to further processing cost, if you deduct the profit margin also and selling and distribution expenses also, then what we get is called net realizable value. But sometimes the profit margin is not given. If profit margin is not given, no problem. Only deduct selling and distribution expenses and further processing costs. Sometimes selling and distribution expenses are also not given, no problem. Then only deduct further processing costs. So simply speaking, in a nutshell, though it is all there, depending upon information, we use that. Simply speaking, what is the net realizable value? It is nothing but the final sale value minus further processing costs. Basically, this is what it is. If any further information related to selling and distribution expenses, etc., is given, that we use it. But if not, simply we get selling price minus further processing cost, sales value minus further processing cost gives us net realizable value. And what is that use of the net realizable value? When we do this, what is the use of that? This is the basis. Once again, this is nothing. This itself has no relevance. That is nothing. That is not representing anything. But what it will be useful as, that is the basis. Only basis means we need a ratio. That ratio is what? The net realizable value ratio. That's all. Look at an example here. An entity incurs a joint cost of 64,500 rupees in producing two products, A and B. Both are 200 units. So 64,500 is the joint cost, it says. Okay, let it be. Then earns a sales revenue of 86,000 rupees total by selling 170 unit per unit of product A and for product B 260 per unit. Okay, let us take product A and product B. So product A, 200 units both. So product A is sold at 170 per unit. So 200 into 170. And product B is sold at 260 per unit. 200 into 260. Fine. Then total of these two sales is 86,000. That is also given. Further processing cost of A and B are 4,000 and 32,000 respectively. So when we have sales value minus further processing cost, if we do, we get net realizable value. Further processing cost is given. How much? 4,000 and 32,000. So how much is the net realizable value? Sales minus further processing cost. That is 30,000 and 20,000. This is net realizable value. What it gives us? Nothing. It only gives us a basis. So what is the basis now? 3:2. That's all. So the 64,500 can be distributed between A and B in the ratio of 3:2. That's all. So 64,500 into 3/5, and B will get 64,500 into 2/5. So what are the joint costs apportioned here? 38,700 and 25,800. Total is still same. That is 64,500. That was the joint cost. But just for understanding purposes, let us calculate profit here. Sales is there, 34,000, right? Now, further processing costs are given already. Now take joint costs also, as we already calculated, 38,700 and 25,800. Now, what is profit? Sales minus for joint costs, of course, minus further processing cost. So from product A, it is 8,700 loss, and for product B, 5,800 loss. But ultimately, total cost, if you see, total sales was only 86,000. Total cost is 64,500 plus 36,000. Total is 1,500,000. Naturally, when there is 1,500,000 cost and 86,000 sales, loss will be 14,500. So like that, it can be calculated, though it is not asked here. Mainly, purpose of calculating net realizable value is only to find out the basis. In this case, which emerged to be 3:2. That's all. So when we can use this method, particularly when the realizable value of the joint products yet the split off is not known. So final product we know, how much petrol can be sold, how much diesel can be sold, that we know. Minus deduct all the further processing costs which can be estimated. From that we can find out net realizable value estimated. That will be used for apportioning the joint costs among the different products. But first of all, why to do this? If that question is there, why to do this? Entire costing has the same question. Because we need to find out what is the real cost per unit of each product. If any company is manufacturing different products, it should know. It is not that total sales are there, total cost is there, profit is there. For that, we don't need costing. Costing purpose is to get the details. Each product, how much it is costing per unit, and how much is contributing to the overall profit of the organization. Like that, each product wise details are to be there. That is why costing goes into much details. While doing so, we face some challenges, something like joint costs. And the answer for that is using the joint costs, apportioning them on some appropriate basis, like physical units method or net realizable value method, or even we can use some technical estimates. We means not we, really they will use some technical estimates. We cannot actually use them here because those will be on the basis of realities. Really, how much is the cost incurred on each of them? They will identify and they will use that as a basis. Otherwise, what also can be taken is as a basis the market value at the point of separation or the split off. Certain products may be sold at split off also, and they can be further processed and sold also. Net realizable value method takes the final sale value after further processing. This method takes what if the products are sold at the point of separation only, how much could be their market value? That can be the basis. And this can be the better method when the further processing costs are incurred disproportionately, completely different way if the further processing costs are incurred. And most importantly, you have the data related to market value of each of the joint products at the point of separation. But difficulty is it will not be available, because at the time of separation these products are all still very raw, they are not still finished. So if available, this method can be definitely used. Which one? Market value at the time of split off. We don't need all multiply factor and all nonsensical things. Just simply you have to use the same data for another method, that's all. See, the same 64,500, we can take it here. This was earlier scenario. Let us take it further. Just same 64,500, how they can be distributed. And we are not talking about any other things here. So 64,500 is the same joint cost, and A and B are same, 200 units are there, and he earns a sales revenue of 86,000 at 170, that is given. So the multiplying factor here will be what? That is the same, right? What is the multiplying factor if at all we calculate that? That is the joint cost divided by total sales revenue. Total sales revenue. It is the same thing. Here we are not taking the net realizable value, we are taking the sales value itself. So whatever the sales value is, that itself we will take here. And how much was the sales value? Already, as we know, that is 170, 260, right? So 200 into 170 and 200 into 260. Total is known already. What is the total? 86,000. Now, what is the ratio? Sales itself is ratio. So do the same. Sales itself is ratio means what? 64,500 divided by 86,000 multiplied with 34,000. For that, we don't need multiplying factors and all that. Not required. If we calculate also, it will be the same. And same way, 64,500 divided by 86,000 into 52,000. So the total is 64,500. That's up. So 25,500, 39,000 is the final joint cost that can be allocated between A and B if we use the sales value as the basis. But here the sales value given is not at split off, it is after further processing. If it is given at split off, we can use that also as a basis. Whatever the data given, according to the data only, we have to use the appropriate basis. And sometimes even the market value after the further processing can be also used as the basis. In this case, then there is just change in data happened. Further, let us say A and B, after further processing, they can be sold at 200 and 300 respectively. Now they are sold at 170 or 260 before further processing. This is a different example. Let us say they can be sold at 200 and 300 respectively. Means what? Simply speaking, total sales value after the further processing is 1 lakh. So this split here will happen on the basis of ratio of 2:3, 40,000 and 60,000. And ultimately, if you use the same ratio, it will be what? 25,800 and 38,700. So ratio here is 4:6 or 2:3. And what basis we have used? Market value after further processing. These are all possible basis. But what is the basis we are going to use? Only net realizable value basis. Keep that in mind. Possibilities are many. We might use even physical unit method if it is asked. We might use other methods also if they are asked and information is given. But if nothing is given, NRV is the basis that we have to always use. And again, I'm reiterating, we are only talking about basis, nothing else. These are all otherwise not at all useful. And what are the basis? Maybe sales value at split off, or maybe sales value after the further processing without deducting any further processing cost. So like this, many methods can be used, and sometimes average unit cost method can also be used, taking the total process cost divided by number of units of joint product produced. Once again, similar to physical units method, but taking an average, ultimately gives rise to same type of result as it is in physical units method. It is not going to have much of difference there. But let us apply some aspects here related to average unit cost method. Find out the cost of joint products, illustration 2, using average unit cost method. Pre-separation joint cost is 60,000. Production data is given, ABC, units produced is 500, 200, 300, average, total is 1000 units. So it's a simple, once again, arithmetical exercise. 60,000 is the total cost divided by 1000 means 60 rupees is the average cost. Multiply with 500, 200, 300, you will get simply whatever the individual values. So 500 into 60, 30,000, 200 into 60, 12,000, 300 into 60, 18,000. That's all. Sir, so what if we apportion this 60,000 in this ratio of 5:2:3? The result will be same. 60,000, if you apportion in the ratio of 5:2:3, result will be still the same, right? 5/10, 3/10, sorry, 2/10. And 3/10. Result will be still the same. So it is as good as physical units method only, nothing different. 30,000, 12,000, 18,000. That is the same basis. So average cost and physical units method more or less same. And sometimes there is another method that can be used also as a contribution margin method, once again, where there will be a little segregation between variable cost and fixed cost. So variable cost is going to be distributed on the basis of physical quantities. And fixed cost is going to be distributed on the basis of contribution ratios. So variable cost is distributed on the basis of units produced, like average method or physical quantities. And fixed costs are apportioned on the basis of contribution ratios, means how much proportion of contribution that is happening from each of the products. So that is the contribution margin method, we can call it. Contribution ratio or contribution margin ratio is also called as PV ratio, that can be calculated by taking contribution by sales into 100 for a percentage expression. Simply it is contribution divided by sales. That will be the basis for fixed cost apportionment. Variable cost apportionment, it is just quantity. Look at illustration 3 for understanding how this works. What is the cost of joint products A and B using the contribution margin method from the following data? Sales is given. A is 100 kgs at the rate of 60 rupees per kg. B is 120 kgs at the rate of 30 rupees per kg. Marginal cost is nothing but variable cost. Variable cost is 4,400. Fixed cost is 3,900. First thing first, this variable cost has to be apportioned between A and B. In what ratio? Physical unit ratio. Means 4,400 into 100 by 220, that gives 2,000. Same way, 4,400 into 120 by 220, that gives 2,400. That is a split of variable cost on the basis of physical quantity. But now the question is, fixed cost has to be apportioned on what ratio? That will be apportioned on the basis of contribution margin ratio. So what is the contribution margin for each of them? That we can find out by taking sales minus variable cost. So take the sales first. A, 6,000. B, 120 into 30, 3,600. Deduct variable cost, which we know already. The sales minus variable cost is what? That is contribution. So 6,000 minus 2,000, which we already know. 3,600 minus 2,400, that also we already know. So what is the contribution now? That is 4,000 and 1,200. That is contribution. But contribution is not the basis that we are taking. We are talking about contribution margin ratio or PV ratio. That can be the basis here. Or even if we take the sales as, because anyway the denominator is same. So the apportionment can happen in this basis of PV ratio. So what is PV ratio here? That is 4/6, 2/3 here, and 12/36, that is 1/3. So 2/3 and 1/3 are the PV ratios. But otherwise we can just use the contribution as in the ratio of contribution. That means taking 40:12 as the basis, or you can call it 40:12 can be called as say 5:10:3, let us say. Yeah, that is the ratio of contribution. That's it. That can be the basis on the basis of which fixed cost 3900 can be just allocated. So 3900 into 10/13 will be 3000, that is to A, and 3900 into 3/13, that is 900, that is allocated to B. So this is contribution margin or contribution basis, we can say, not going with PV ratios and all, just taking the contribution itself as a basis. So that is one more thing. If ratio itself is taken, PV ratio is taken, that can be another basis. See, basis is all what we want. Some basis if we want, contribution is the basis, this is the basis. If PV ratio has to be the basis, that can be a basis also. According to requirement of the question, we have to just use the data for ultimately apportioning the joint costs among joint products. That is our ultimate objective. Clear? That is about the basic background of this chapter, that is joint products and byproducts. Now let us solve some of the questions for practice. Illustration number 4. So far all the things are there only for general understanding. Examination questions can be like this. Illustration 4 is possible examination question. Inorganic chemicals purchases salt and processes into more refined products like caustic soda, chlorine and PVC. In the month of July, that company has purchased salt for 40,000 rupees. That is material cost, and a conversion cost of 60,000 rupees has also been incurred. That means a total cost of 1 lakh was incurred up to the split off point. So how much is the joint cost here? 1 lakh rupees is the joint cost. That is clear. But our objective here naturally will be how this 1 lakh has to be segregated, apportioned among the joint products. And at the split off point, there are two saleable products or saleable products, whatever the way it is. Two products are produced. What are those? One is caustic soda and one is chlorine. These two are produced, and chlorine can be further processed into PVC. So PVC is coming from chlorine only. We have to read the question carefully. So ultimately, after the entire further processing of chlorine happened, three products emerge: chlorine and PVC. But caustic soda does not require any further processing because that has emerged at the point of split off itself. So at the point of split off, there are only two joint products at the time of split off. That is what? One is caustic soda, other one is chlorine. If chlorine is further processed, then it would result in PVC. Look at the data. In July, the production and sales information is as follows. Production in tons, caustic soda 1200 tons, chlorine is 800 tons. Sales also is same. Selling price per ton for caustic soda is given. Chlorine is not sold. Chlorine, what happened? Though it emerged at the time of split off, it is not sold. It is further converted into PVC. So by converting 800 tons, how much of PVC was manufactured? Only 500 tons of PVC was manufactured. Ultimate output is 500 tons only, which is sales also, and selling price per ton of PVC is 200. And that's what is given in the explanation. All 800 tons of chlorine were further processed at an incremental cost of 20,000 rupees. So what is the further processing cost here for chlorine? That is 20,000 rupees. That is called incremental cost, further processing cost, or the cost after the split off. That is 20,000 rupees. And after doing that, only the 500 tons of PVC has come. And there was no beginning or ending inventories of any of these products. And there is an active market for chlorine. Inorganic chemicals could have sold all of its July production of chlorine at 75 rupees per ton. If it wanted, it could have sold chlorine also at 75, because chlorine is also a product which they can sell, but they didn't choose that. They have chosen to process chlorine further into PVC. Now they are not selling chlorine, they are selling PVC. And 800 tons of chlorine converted to 500 tons of PVC only. What happened to the remaining 300 tons? We cannot ask. It is gone. It is a process, right? A lot of wastage will happen. That is none of our business. Ultimately, 500 tons of PVC is produced after further processing. Now, using these methods, what is required is, how this joint cost of 1 lakh has to be apportioned between caustic soda and chlorine. Why? Because those are the joint products till split off. Till split off, those are the only two joint products. Under each of the following methods. One is sales value at split off. That is one method he's asking. Second one is physical unit method. Okay. And estimated net realizable value method. All three methods, majorly the methods which are used in reality, are the three methods. All of them are asked in this question. That is question number one. Question number two is a continuation of it. It says, Lifetime Swimming Pool Products offers to purchase the entire 800 tons of chlorine at the rate of 75 per ton. Anyway, this sale of chlorine would mean that no PVC could be produced in August. Explain how the acceptance of this offer for the month of August would affect the operating income. So instead of processing the chlorine further into PVC, if it sells the chlorine itself at 75 rupees to whomever, Lifetime, whoever they are, then how much it will have an impact on the operating income, means profit, how it will be affected, is the second question. We'll come to that later. First, let us understand the segregation of joint costs, how that has to be done among the two products on different basis. So what are the two products here? Let us say caustic soda, and second one is chlorine. Let us take two products. And what are the basis we are talking about? Joint costs are common, that we know already. That is how much? That is 1 lakh rupees. That is already known. Basis only changes. First basis, sales value at split off. So what is the sales value at split off? Caustic soda, 1200 tons. That can be sold at split off only, because there is no further processing for that. So it is multiplied with 50 will be the sales value of caustic soda at split off, 1200 into 50, right? And same way for chlorine at a split off, if it is sold, if that was given as if it is sold 75 rupees also, it can be sold, chlorine can be sold at split off. So sales value at split off point for chlorine would be how much? It would have been 800 tons of chlorine multiplied with 75 rupees. That is also 60,000, which means equal. So the ratio here is equal. Then naturally, what is the apportionment of joint cost? Equal. So this 1 lakh will be apportioned like this in the first scenario. That is first question, sales value at split off. Second question, or second bit of the first question, says, or A, we can say, this is A, this is B bit. Now second bit says, what is the second one? Physical unit method. Physical unit method means we already have the data. So what is the quantity of the caustic soda and chlorine? 1200 and 800. That is the basis. 1200, 800. In other words, how much? If we say 4, 3 is to 2, that's it. 3 is to 2 is the basis. Apportion that on the basis of this. So 1200 divided by 2000, that is 60,000. Naturally, the remaining will be for chlorine, or you can calculate 1 lakh into 800 by 2000. Simple. So that is the second basis, which is physical unit method. Then the third one is the most important one, that is estimated net realizable value method. So net realizable value method, we have to take caustic soda and not chlorine, actually we have to take PVC, because what is further processed is PVC. So what is the sale value finally? Final sale value. Caustic soda, though, anyway, it will be same because there is no further processing for that. So it will be what? 1200 into 50. Same 60,000 that we already have. But what about PVC? If it is further processed, 500 tons of PVC can be sold at the rate of 200 rupees per ton. 1 lakh rupees can be the sales revenue from PVC. From that, what we have to reduce is further processing costs. For caustic soda, there is no further processing cost. But for PVC, there was a further processing cost of 20,000. Which means, what is the net realizable value? Sales value minus further processing cost. This is NRV in this case. 60,000 and 80,000. In other words, 3:4 is the ratio in which 1 lakh rupees has to be apportioned. Always it is the same. So, approximately that comes to 42,857. And remaining is 57,143. Total should be equal to 1 lakh naturally. That's it. That was the question actually asked. So you can look at the different ways of apportionment of the joint cost. In the first case, 50-50, that was the first answer. Second case, 60,000-40,000, that is how the joint costs are apportioned. And in the third case, 42,857 and 57,143. That is how the joint cost of 1 lakh has to be apportioned between caustic soda and PVC or chlorine, that is what is further processed into PVC. Now the question number 2 says whether the company should accept the offer of whoever this swimming pool products people are there, 75 rupees chlorine. It's a decision making commonsensical question. In order to process the chlorine further into PVC, it requires additional 20,000 rupees cost. But how much additional revenue it can make if it further processes into PVC? Because if it doesn't process further, if it sells chlorine at 75, it can make only 60,000 rupees. If it processes into PVC, it can sell at 1 lakh. So additional revenue is how much? 40,000. Additional cost is how much? 20,000. So if it converts into PVC, it could have made a profit of additional 20,000, which will be missing if it accepts the offer of this lifetime swimming pool products. Which means if it accepts the offer, the profit will reduce by 20,000 rupees. That's what you have to just write it as a conclusion. So if it sells the chlorine to these people, it will have a negative impact on the operating income. The operating income will be reduced by 20,000 rupees. Because it is missing that additional profit of 20,000, which it could have generated by processing the chlorine further into PVC. That's it. That is about joint products and apportionment of joint costs among the joint products. Then what about byproducts? See, as far as byproducts is concerned, we don't have to really look at the details of them. Why? Because if it is really a byproduct also, joint product also, we don't have to distinguish in the numerical questions. In the numerical questions, we don't care. Reality only, there is a difference between joint product and byproduct. If the byproduct is really of very small value, then its sale value can be credited to the costing P&L account. If its byproduct is having little bit reasonable value, then it can be reduced from the total cost. So as good as something like not important aspect, byproduct will be treated like. But of course, when the byproduct is sold, there is a big money, whatever that is earned by the company. How to treat it? Yes, will be a theory question. If the byproduct is having a little bit scrap value type of situation, that can be credited to the costing P&L account. Credit why? Because it is income. If byproduct is having little bit more value than that, then it can be reduced from the total cost. That is also effectively same. So what if the byproduct is having considerable value? Then better to consider it as joint product but not as byproduct. So this byproduct is not a special thing. It is a, logically speaking, same treatment like joint product. We can use the net realizable value method for that also, no problem. So numerical calculations, we don't need to really worry which is a byproduct and is a joint product. Even in some of the examples given earlier, coal, coke, and etc., small products are there. Those can be byproducts, but the calculations will not differ. They'll be more or less the same. Reality will differ. So that is about this small chapter of joint products and byproducts. Conceptual discussion of that is done. Now you can have a quick review of the things that were discussed also. These are the various methods that can be used for apportioning the joint cost, and byproducts also can use the similar methods, and how to treat byproducts sale value is also, this can be a theory question. This is a theory question, how byproducts will be treated in the cost accounting. This is a theory question. Exactly this answer is enough. What you have to write is this only. Don't worry about all the other things. Simply this is what you have to write. What is that? If there is a very small total value, they may be credited to costing P&L account, or they may be reduced from total cost also. Or if they are considerable value, they are considered as good as joint products only. If they require further processing, then same like joint products, they will also be treated using realizable value of byproducts. That's it. So that is about a logical arithmetical application of joint products and byproducts topic, which is once again more of a arithmetic exercise than any conceptual thing. But still, yes, what are the details given in the question, we have to use them. Some basis will be asked, we have to use them. What else we can do? Let us look at this question here that is given in the ICA material also. Is Sun Moon Limited produces and sells the following products. A, B, C, D, E, five products are there. And number of units manufactured is given. Selling price at a split off point is also given. Selling price after further processing is also given. But for D, there is no further processing, that is evident. Means A, B, C, E can be further processed. So D, there is nothing, that itself is a final product. Then raw material cost is 35,90,000. Other manufacturing expenses are 5,47,000 rupees in the manufacturing process, which are absorbed on the products on the basis of net realizable value. That is given very clearly. What is the basis to be used? Basis to be used is NRV. Naturally, that will be the most commonly used basis. The further processing cost of A, B, C, E are given also in the question. Fixed costs are also given 4,73,000, which are not apportioned already. They can be taken as a reduction at a later level. If there is no requirement of apportioning them, don't apportion them. When there is a requirement of apportioning joint cost, that only we will do. For a company as a whole, fixed costs are common. We don't need product-wise fixed costs. Totally for the company, fixed costs are 473,000. Required to prepare the following in respect of the coming year. One, statement showing the income forecast of the company, assuming that none of the products are to be further processed. Second, statement showing the income forecast of the company, assuming that A, B, C, E are to be further processed. And also is asking, can you suggest any other production plan whereby the company can maximize its profits? Out of 2 points they have given, maybe we can come out with something better plan than what they have. What plans they have? None of the products are further processed is one plan. A, B, C, E are further processed is another plan. Let us come to a situation where maybe there is another plan that comes out. If we adopt that plan, that can maximize the profits. We'll see that. We don't know. We cannot imagine that now unless we have the numbers in front of us. So first and foremost important point is we have to prepare income statement and income forecast. When None of the products are further processed. That was the first question. So let us do that first. None of the products are further processed. But what are the products here? A, B, C, D, E. So take them. None of the products are further processed means all products are sold at split off only. So the selling price at split off is given. This is what is going to happen when there is no further processing at all. So all that you need to do is a great multiplication job. 2 lakhs into 17. Then 30,000 into 13. Then 25,000 into 8. Then 20,000 into 10. Then 75,000 into 14. So these are the sales if they are happening at the split off. And joint costs are there already. There will not be any further processing costs. So joint costs will have to be apportioned on what basis? Same basis. So let us take the same basis as total. What is the total of all this? That comes to 52,40,000. And what are the joint costs that are known already given? 35,90,000 plus 5,47,000. Both are joint costs only. Materials and other manufacturing costs. So 41,37,000 is a joint cost. No further processing cost because there is no further processing at all. So how to allocate these joint costs? This is the basis. Just allocate them on the basis of sale value at split off, right? Do this on calculator, you will get this automatically. So total is 41,73,000. So basically joint cost 41,37,000 into 34 lakhs divided by 52,40,000. Same way, 41,37,000 into 390 divided by 52,40,000. Like this, if we do, this is a joint cost allocation, and these are the only costs. So what is the profit here? We can say before deducting fixed costs, that is 11,03,000. So this is the profit that is coming from each of the products. The total of the profit is 11,03,000, but it is not over. Fixed costs are there, 473,000. That can be deducted only from the total because we don't know. We are not allocating that to the products. Those are commonly for the company as a whole. So what is the profit under this plan if the company doesn't process further any of the products? 6,30,000. That's what is asked there. Right, that is first question answer. Second question answer: statement showing income forecast of the company assuming A, B, C, E are processed further. So naturally the numbers will change. So let us take the numbers once again. Here we need a basis also, particularly speaking. So let us take the cost apportionment first, then we can prepare the income statement, or you can do cost apportionment as a working note also, as the case may be. First of all, what are the joint costs? Those are same. Those are definitely same. That is 41,37,000. There is no difference in that. 41,37,000. But what should be the basis here? Basis should be net realizable value basis when there is a further processing of A, B, C, E that is happening. So first, net realizable value will start with sales price. So here You can change the prices only. 25, 17, 12, 20. 25, 17, C12, D same, E20. D is not further processed. So it will be sold at same price of 10 rupees. That is 2 lakhs. So this is the sales value after further processing. Now from this we have to reduce further processing cost to get NRV, that is net realizable value. What are further processing costs which are given in the question? 12,50,000, 150, 50 and 150. So 12,50,000, 150, 1,50,000, 50, not here, D0, is 150. So that is the further processing cost. So this is sale value. Once you reduce further processing cost from sales value, what you get is called NRV. Now we have a basis now. What is this? We have a basis for apportionment of joint costs. What is the basis? This is the basis. That is net realizable value basis. So 59,10,000 is the total of net realizable value. That will be the basis for apportionment of joint costs. So apportion the joint costs first, or you can prepare a statement now. Finally, using the further processing data and joint cost data also. But before that, let us first complete the joint cost allocation. Joint cost allocation 41,37,000, that is common, that is same. That has to be allocated now, apportioned on the basis of NRV, that is net realizable value. So take that. How that can be taken? Same way as we have taken earlier. Total will be 41 lakh, should be ideally, no? So basis, you have to do these calculations. Basis is NRV. So simply speaking, 41,37,000 into 37,50 divided by 59,10. That gives 26,25,000. Like this, for each of them, we have the joint cost allocation for the entire 41,37,000. Now we can prepare the income statement. So let us prepare income statement. From this information that we have. Sales will be same, 50 lakhs, 5,10,000, 3 lakhs, 2 lakhs and 15 lakhs. So total sales is same. Now take the joint costs. Joint costs are how much? We have this joint costs. Total of them 41,37,000. Take the further processing costs also. That is also cost, right? So further processing costs are how much? Already known that also. For A, B, C, E, there is a further processing cost. Total of 16 lakhs. So what is the profit? Sales minus cost is profit simply. How much is that? 17,73,000. 17,73,000 is a profit. From that, if you reduce fixed cost, which is 4,73,000, the profit emerges in the option number 2, that is further processing will be 13 lakhs rupees. That's all. This is profit before fixed cost. After fixed cost, 13 lakhs rupees is the profit. But now he's not stopping there. He's asking about, will you suggest anything better? Let us look at the products one by one, then only we can suggest something better. In the original case, for product A, without further processing, 7,15,000 something was the profit. Now the profit is 11,25, which is good, better. So that is good. B, if you see, B, 82,094 only was the profit. Now, 1,08,000 is the profit. C had earlier 42,000 profit, now 75,000 profit. D anyway is not going to be further processed at all. E had 221, now it has 405. So with this, all are looking like better to further process, but we have used different bases, so they become not comparable, because in the first calculation we have taken for joint cost allocation the sales value at split off as a basis, but the question said it is to be taken net realizable value as the only basis. If none of the products are further processed, it is only a decision making point. The apportionment is not going to change. That's what we have to assume or interpret. So if we take like that, the original calculation will also change. The joint cost separation will happen according to NRV basis, which we already calculated. So this is the new allocation. Of course, the total profit will not change. But if you observe the profit for each of the products, A had 775,000 profit, now it has 1125. B had 138, now it has only 108, which means what? B, after further processing, is losing 30,000. C, from 25,000, it increases to 75. D will not have any difference because it is not processed at all. E also has increased its profit from 105 to 405. Only B is not adding value, rather from the earlier calculation it has decreased the profit. So what we can also say is, as a decision making or a advice, B need not be further processed. B better to be sold at split off. Don't further process that, and we have to implement that decision and once again recalculate the profit. Once again the entire thing has to be recalculated. But now what is the decision? B is not going to be further processed. So sales will be same, A 50 lakhs, B will not be same, B will have 3,90,000 only as the sales, which is no further processing, and C and D and E will have the same sales. Now the sales are 73,90,000. Joint costs, we know already how that split happens, which we have taken already. The total will be definitely 41,37,000. Further processing cost of B will not be there now. Why? Because we are not going to process it further. Remaining things are all same. Now what happened to the profit? From 13 lakhs, it has increased to 13,30,000. So this is a better decision. Not to process B, but A, C, E to be processed. B and D not to be processed. So recalculate the entire thing. We'll get 13,30,000 as a final profit. So you need to do these calculations on paper. Then the total profit will emerge. So main point here is, the original first question also, basis is NRV only. Basis is not sales value at split off, as we have done earlier. NRV basis only will do for joint cost apportionment, but none of the products is further processed, that's all. So first, if you have the NRV basis, how much joint cost should be apportioned, then option A gives, option 1 gives 6,30,000 profit, option 2 gives 13 lakhs profit, option 3 gives 13,30,000 profit. That is the question which is there in the ICA material also. And similar questions can be expected even in the examinations also. Anyway, these are the same questions which are there in CHAMS material as well, which is taken from the ICAI study material. So first question is same what we did already. Second question is also what we did. Some exam questions, past exam questions are there. I think question number 3, let us do this. A company manufactures one main product M1 and two by-products B1 and B2 for the month of January. Following details are available. The total cost up to separation point is 212,400 rupees, and further processing costs are there for B1 and B2. 35,000 and 24,000. Number of units produced is given. Selling price per unit is given. Estimated net profit as a not parentage percentage. So as a percentage to sales value is given for B1, B2, and estimated selling expenses as a percentage to sales value is also given. No beginning or closing inventories. What we need to do is allocate the joint cost and also product wise overall profitability of the company for January 2013 is asking. See, this is a byproducts related question majorly. Main product is there, which is M1. Byproducts are there, B1 and B2. So we can find out when we have the sale value of B1 and B2. B1 is there, B2 is there. What is the sale value of them? We know already. What is the sale value of that? Number of units produced is given, 1800 into 40. Same way for B2, 3000 into 30. So that is sale value. Selling price is given, 1800 into 40, 3000 into 30. Then what is the estimated profit as a percentage to sales value? 20% and 30%, that is given. So if you reduce the profit from the sales, we'll get cost, total cost of B1, B2, right? Net profit as a percentage to sales value only is given. So 20% of this and 30% of this. So 20% and 30% is a profit on sales. If you reduce that profit from sales, naturally you will get total cost of B1 and B2. Total cost. And further processing cost, if you reduce from that, naturally you will get the joint cost, because total cost is nothing but joint cost plus costs after separation. Cost after separation are given. How much? 35,000 and 24,000. Which means, what are joint costs? So there is no allocation. Directly we can arrive at that. So total cost minus further processing cost. So joint costs related to B1 and B2 are how much now? 22,600 and 39,000. That is the first calculation from the data that can be found out. That is allocation of joint cost. 22,600, 39,000. So then what about M, which is main product? M1, you can call it whatever the name given. So M1 is the main product. Naturally, the remaining joint cost will be related to that only. What was the total joint cost? 212,400. So 212,400 minus these two will give what would be the joint cost related to M1. That's it. That is the joint cost allocation among three products. Then he's asking what is the product wise and overall profitability of the company. So once again, profitability, if we can take one by one, we can take that. Total also is asking, so take total column also. Sales first. Sales is same. For B1 and B2, sales are same. That is 72,000 and 90,000. Then for M1, what is sales? 4,000 into 100. Means 4 lakhs. Right? That is the sales of M1. Total, you write it in the total column. That is sales. Then reduce joint costs first. Joint costs, as we know already, how much are joint costs? 22,600, 39,000 and 150,800. Total of joint cost is 212,400. We know that already. Then reduce also further processing cost. Further processing cost for B1 and B2 is already known, 35,000, 24,000. For M1, it is zero because there is no further processing. That is the main product. So that is no cost after separation and all. This is not a joint product. So M1 doesn't have any further processing cost. So what is the total of this further processing cost? 59,000. So naturally, how much will be the profit? Same. Sales minus joint costs minus further processing costs. We know already that, which is 14,400, 27,000 for B1, B2, but for M1 it is how much now? 249,200. And what is the total of the profit is 2,90,600. That's it. That's all. The total profit here is 2,90,600. That is the answer. That's what is asked also. And for M1, there is no other cost. Up to separation only there are costs. Costs after separation are not given. And by the way, yeah, selling expenses are there. I think we forgot that. Let us reduce that also. Selling expenses. Then we have to reduce here also. It will change, you know. Correct. Estimated selling expenses as percentage to sales value. So, no, here also we have to include that. Selling expenses has to be also reduced. Little bit changes will happen. Selling expenses, how much is that? For M1 is 20% of sales value. For B1 and B2, 15% of sales value. So, let us take 15% of sales value as selling expenses. This also is 15% of sales value. Now the total cost is definitely going to be different. Sales minus profit, that is true. That is total cost, no doubt. Let us put total cost here. Selling expenses down. So sales minus profit is total cost, there is no doubt, but that cost includes selling expenses, right? So this is total cost. Selling expenses are there and further processing costs are given already, but now how much will be the joint cost? Joint cost will be how much? Total cost minus of selling expenses minus of further processing cost. No, this is not possible. This cannot be the joint cost negative. So let us take the joint cost calculation as it is without any change in that. So here, whatever the joint cost was there, let us take it like that only. Now let us take selling expenses separately for B1 and B2. So here for B1, selling expenses will be 15% of sales and for B2 also it will be 15% of sales. For M1 it is 20% of sales. So the total is different now. Profit will definitely reduce because of selling expenses also. So profit is now 1,86,300. but when the word net profit is used, it should be as a percentage of sales value. Net profit is given 20% and 30%. 20%, 30%. Okay, this is total cost. Further processing cost is 35,000. And selling expenses are 10,800. Why was coming earlier wrong? I think this formula and the links are all going helter shelter. Let us calculate this one separately without taking any numbers. So here links are creating issue. When we have total cost this much, further processing cost this much, and selling expenses are there, should be there, negative is not possible. Definitely selling expenses will come. Here, how much is that? 10,800. Let's take values without links and all. 10,800 and 13,500. That is the selling expenses. So we have sales. Profit is reduced from that, total cost we have, and selling expense and further processing costs are there, means how much will be the joint cost? Total cost minus of selling expenses minus of further processing cost. Yes, that is 11,800 is joint cost. Correct. So naturally B2 will have a joint cost of 25,500. M1 will have a joint cost of 1,75,100. So that is a joint cost allocation which goes to B1 and B2 and M1. Sales minus profit gives total cost minus selling expenses and further processing cost gives us naturally the joint cost, because already the total cost includes further processing cost also, joint cost also, selling expense also. So joint cost for B1 and B2, once we know, we can come to know what is the joint cost of M1 also. So 175,100 is the joint cost of M1. So when we have the sales separately for each of them, joint costs are taken directly from there. Further processing costs are already known, 35 and 24. Selling expenses are also already known, which is 10,800, 13,500 and 80,000. Then we have 1,86,300 as the final profit amount coming to the company as a whole. That is about this question, which was given in exams in May 2013. Calculations, if done on paper, they are better. Definitely, yes. On system, sometimes links will go helter shelter and that will cause unnecessary hurdles. That's okay. As long as we know what we are doing, that is fine. So this computation of profit after allocating the joint cost among the products is the requirement of the question. With that, we can conclude this chapter of joint products and byproducts, which is once again only arithmetical exercise mostly than any other conceptual, I would say, depth related chapter. Fine then, till we meet in the next session, take care. Bye-bye. Thank you very much.